Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Machiavelli, Philosopher of Power, by Ross King, narrated by Timothy Reynolds and directed by Lynn Flanagan. This book is copyrighted 2007 by Ross King. This recording is copyrighted 2007 by Recorded Books. The Prince, Niccolò Machiavelli's Handbook on Power, How to Get It and How to Keep It, has been enormously influential in the centuries since it was written, garnering a heady mixture of admiration, fear, and contempt. Its author, born to an established middle-class family, was no prince himself, however. One of the most vilified and misunderstood writers in history, his writings bulge with complexities and contradictions, and his numerous undertakings, diplomat, playwright, poet, historian, political theorist, farmer, military engineer, and militia captain, make him a true Renaissance man. In this new biography, Ross King rescues Machiavelli's legacy from caricature, detailing the vibrant political and social context that influenced his thought and underscoring the humanity of one of history's finest political thinkers. And now, Machiavelli, Philosopher of Power.
Chapter 1. A strange, new type of insect appeared in the meadows beside the River Arno in Florence in the summer of 1498. These swarms of gold-bodied caterpillars had a human face. Eyes and nose could be distinguished, while on the head was a golden halo and a small cross. They quickly became known as Brother Girolamo's caterpillars. Brother Girolamo was Girolamo Savonarola, a charismatic, green-eyed Dominican friar from Ferrara, who for the previous 6 years had dominated Florence's spiritual and political life with his fire and brimstone sermons. By 1498, however, his mesmeric hold over the city had finally been broken. He was excommunicated by Pope Alexander VI in the summer of 1497, and less than a year later, on the morning of May 23rd, 1498, he was hanged in the city's main piazza, as punishment for, in the words of one chronicler, stirring up discord in Florence and of disseminating doctrine that was not entirely Catholic. Cut down from the scaffold, his body was consumed on a bonfire. Afterward, his ashes were thrown into the Arno from the Ponte Vecchio, washing downstream to the spot where, a few weeks later, the caterpillars mysteriously appeared. Savonarola was not the only casualty in Florence in May of 1498. Two Dominican priests were hanged beside him, while other supporters of Savonarola, known by their opponents as Piagnoni, snivellers, suffered equally unpleasant fates. The friar's most powerful political ally, Francesco Valori, was murdered with a billhook. A bolt from a crossbow killed Valori's wife. Dozens of other Piagnoni were fined or deprived of their political rights, and several friars from the convent of San Marco, where Savonarola had served as prior, were sent into exile. Even the bell of San Marco, nicknamed La Piagnona, did not escape punishment. It was removed from its tower and given a public flogging before it, too, was exiled from Florence. Retribution reached the highest levels of government as the Signoria, Florence's ruling council, began an immediate purge of Savonarola's sympathizers from their official posts. All 10 members of the Dieci di Libertà e Pace, 10 of Liberty and Peace, who handled foreign policy, were dismissed, as were the 8 men comprising of the Otto di Guardia, 8 of the Watch, the committee in charge of criminal justice. Also losing his post was an official in the Chancellery named Alessandro Braccesi. His replacement was a 29-year-old political novice named Niccolò Machiavelli. 29, the age of eligibility for voting, was a remarkably young age for a man to hold such an important post. Most young men in Florence remained under the authority of their fathers until the age of 24, and some did not achieve their legal majority until 28. But Machiavelli would make up for his youth and inexperience with a formidable intellect and an impeccable education, and with tremendous amounts of energy and ambition. Machiavelli had been born in Florence on May 3rd, 1469, the eldest son of Bernardo Machiavelli and his wife, Bartolomea. I was born in poverty, Niccolò would later write, and at an early age learned how to scrimp rather than to thrive. Like many things he wrote, this claim is something of an overstatement. His mother seems to have descended from an ancient and distinguished family, while his father came from a prosperous clan that for many generations had owned large tracts of land in the rolling, vine-clad hills south of Florence. It is true that Bernardo Machiavelli was by no means a rich man. He once described himself on a tax document, all too truthfully, as being without gainful employment. But he lived in a large house in the Santo Spirito quarter of Florence, near the Ponte Vecchio, and he also owned a farm outside Florence in the village of Sant'Andrea in Percussina, complete with vineyards, apple orchards, olive trees, and livestock. His rural possessions, furthermore, included a tavern and a butcher shop. Bernardo Machiavelli had trained for a legal career and then pursued, not very diligently or successfully, a career as a notary. However, he evidently enjoyed a reputation in Florence as a first-class legal brain. He became friends with the Chancellor of Florence, an eminent scholar named Bartolomeo Scala, who featured him as a legal expert in a 1483 treatise entitled Dialogue on Laws and Legal Judgments. But Bernardo's most notable trait was his passion for books. His formal education would have seen him studying Latin grammar, perfecting his handwriting, and learning how to compose wills and certify business and marriage contracts. His mind roved more broadly and searchingly over human affairs than such paperwork would suggest, and by the 1470s, he was dabbling in classical literature. Scala's Dialogue may well have done him justice by having him knowledgeably quote authors such as Plato, Justinian, Cicero, and Lactantius. Bernardo certainly acquired for his personal library, sometimes at no mean expense, editions of works by writers such as Livy and Macrobius. And he borrowed books, when he could not afford to buy them, from institutions such as the library at the convent of Santa Croce. One of his most prized possessions was an edition of Livy's History of Rome that he acquired for free by compiling an index of place names for its Florentine printer. 11 years later, in 1486, he had the volume bound in leather, a task for which he compensated the binder with 3 bottles of red wine from his estate in the country. Bernardo was far from alone in his reverence for classical literature and history. An intense preoccupation with the culture of the ancient world had placed Florence at the forefront of new intellectual and artistic activities, what later came to be known as humanism, that shifted the intellectual emphasis from theology to the more secular studies that had once been the bedrock of classical literature. The head of the Florentine Chancellery between 1375 and 1406, a scholar named Coluccio Salutati, had argued that classical texts could teach important lessons about contemporary moral and political life not found in the Bible. He and his followers approached the texts of the ancients in a hands-on fashion, treating them, in effect, as how-to manuals replete with practical wisdom about everyday civil and moral life. They believed the works of the ancient Greeks and Romans could demonstrate, among other things, how best to educate children, deliver a speech, become a good citizen, or govern a state, actions and pursuits that would make a person and a society happy and prosperous. The humanists offered 15th-century Europeans a new way of looking at the world and at man's place in it. They took their inspiration from, among other sources, the claim by the Greek philosopher Protagoras that man is the measure of all things. For medieval Christians, the government, laws, and morals of a society were fixed by God. But for the humanists of the 15th century, as for the ancient Greeks and Romans, these institutions were man-made and, as such, both worthy of scrutiny and susceptible to change. Though many humanists were devout Christians, their interest lay in human affairs rather than transcendental values. Critically, they emphasized the classical rather than the Christian view of human nature. Man was seen not as corrupted by original sin and in need of salvation through God's grace, but as free, creative, and self-determining, capable of both higher reason and base passions. Bernardo seems to have been determined that, despite the costs involved, his son should receive the benefits of the humanist culture flourishing in Florence. 3 days after his 7th birthday, Niccolò began learning the elements of Latin under the supervision of a local teacher known as Maestro Matteo, who conducted lessons from a house near the Ponte Santa Trinità, a short distance from the Machiavelli home. Within a few years, he was studying arithmetic and composing in Latin under the tutelage of a more distinguished master by the name of Paolo da Ronciglione. A teacher of some reputation, Paolo was also a friend and colleague of the great humanist scholar Cristoforo Landino, whose commentary on Dante, published in 1481, so impressed Florence's city fathers that, such was the esteem in which poets and scholars were held in those days, he was rewarded with a castle. Machiavelli then seems to have progressed to the institution in which Landino himself held his professorship in poetry and oratory, the Studio Fiorentino, a university founded in 1348, but relocated in 1473 to Pisa. Virtually nothing is known of Machiavelli's school days, but it seems safe to assume that he prospered in the lively intellectual atmosphere of the studio. He was an enchanting companion. He might have been an unprepossessing physical specimen, slenderly built as he was, with thin lips, a weak chin, sunken cheeks, and closely cropped black hair, but he had a sharp wit and a love of jollity and farce that belied the ascetic appearance. Most portraits of him, albeit made posthumously, would feature an ironic smile playing at his lips. Though a voracious reader of the classics, he could also devote himself to less elevated pursuits, such as gambling and the company of prostitutes. According to one friend, he abounded in charm and drolleries, while another claimed his jokes and witticisms made everyone split their sides laughing. He became known as Macchia, a pun on macchia, meaning a smear or a stain, a reference to the damage inflicted by his sharp tongue and irreverent wit. The studio would have given Machiavelli a solid grounding in such core disciplines of the humanist syllabus as rhetoric, grammar, poetry, history, and moral philosophy. One text he appears to have studied with some care, since he copied out the 7,400-line poem by hand, was the Roman philosopher Lucretius's De Rerum Natura, On the Nature of Things, the sole manuscript of which had been rediscovered and brought back to Florence in 1417. The young Machiavelli may well have been intrigued by the central argument of Lucretius, that fear and religious superstition should be banished by means of the application of reason and a close study of the inner workings of nature. Machiavelli concerned himself with poetry as well as philosophy. 3 of his youthful efforts were collected together in a volume of poetry illustrated with drawings by the painter Sandro Botticelli. The volume also included 10 poems by Lorenzo de' Medici, called The Magnificent, who had been the de facto ruler of Florence from 1469, the year, coincidentally, of Machiavelli's birth, until his death in 1492. The Medici were the wealthiest and most powerful family in Florence. Lorenzo's grandfather, Cosimo de' Medici, son of the richest banker in Europe, had become the virtual overlord of Florence in 1434 after ousting the existing government. The family had then maintained control of the city for 6 decades, nominally respecting the Republic's institutions, but in fact concentrating power in the hands of their supporters. Cosimo and Lorenzo had both been generous and discerning patrons of the arts, funded churches and palaces, and provided support for the famous Neoplatonic Academy that met outside Florence at the Villa di Careggi. Just how close Machiavelli was to the Medici remains a matter of conjecture. He seems to have been, at least for a time, a member of the circle of humanist scholars, artists, and philosophers, an exalted group that included the young Michelangelo, who were cultivated by Lorenzo. One of Machiavelli's poems was even dedicated to Giuliano de' Medici, Lorenzo's youngest son, who would have been an adolescent when the poems were collected in the early 1490s. Whatever the nature of the association, It was dramatically severed in 1494, when a popular uprising against Lorenzo's arrogant and incompetent eldest son, Piero, known as Lo Sfortunato, the unfortunate, forced the Medici into exile. By the time he reached his late 20s, Machiavelli had found the career in which to exploit his many talents. Politics was in the Machiavelli blood. Over the previous two centuries, numerous members of the clan had held political office in Florence. Altogether, 13 Machiavelli had at one time or another been elevated to the highest civic post, that of gonfalonier, standard-bearer of justice. The most colourful career had been that forged by Giovanni Machiavelli, a contemporary of Dante who was elected to high office on several occasions, despite having murdered a priest and been accused of rape. The only other Machiavelli to make names for themselves were Francesco and Girolamo, second cousins of Bernardo. Both were beheaded for opposing Cosimo de' Medici's oligarchic regime. Undaunted by the fate of these relations, Niccolò seems to have plunged into politics in the tempestuous months preceding Savonarola's downfall. Early in 1498.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.